Today we're in a very difficult passage. I'm going to just start out by saying that it's a difficult passage, like last week wasn't. This one is too. We're going to be looking at a topic that is worthy of much more time and much more development than I can give on a Sunday morning. We're going to be looking at Matthew 18, 21 through 35, a passage that deals with forgiving one another. Originally, when I gave this study many years ago, I simply called it the parable of the debt collector. And you're going to see in this passage what happens when we do not forgive somebody who sinned against us. And so beginning at verse 21, Jesus gives this parable. Verse 21, Matthew chapter 18. Peter came to him and said, "Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?" And Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, 'Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, 'Pay me what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' He would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved, and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you?' His master was angry, delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father also will do to each of you, if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses." One of the things about parables you need to remember is there's a germ of truth there that the Lord is wanting us to capture. There's certain thing that he wants us to know. And so when you study parables, and Jesus gave a number of parables, You don't necessarily take every line in every verse and say, this means this, this means that. What you're looking for is the center. And the center of this particular parable that we're going to be looking at relates to forgiveness. Because a question has been asked of the Lord Jesus Christ related to that subject when Peter in verse 21 came to him and said, "How often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him?" So the germ of this, the center of this particular parable that Jesus is giving revolves around the theme of forgiveness. And so that's what we'll be looking at today, forgiving one another. Now, as we've been going through chapter 18 here in Matthew, Jesus has been teaching that believers are like children. And he had illustrated that, as we saw in verses 2 and 3, by taking a toddler and using this toddler as an example. And so he's been speaking concerning a variety of things that pertain to children and things about children that help us to understand relationships with God, with the body of Christ, with one another, if you will. And so he's speaking concerning forgiveness in this passage, in this portion. And so what he would be doing is he'd be helping us to see that believers should be forgiven as easily as we forgive our children when they fail. You see, as it begins, it says here that how often shall my brother sin against me? So that tells us that Peter is speaking about a brother. He's speaking about a fellow believer. So believers should be forgiven as easily as we forgive our children. Now, normally, if you're a parent, normally, you're very quick to forgive a child. Especially when you realize that the child can do some things innocently without knowing it. They do something that is something that really upsets you, but They did it naively. They did it innocently. I remember my sister Rebecca and my sister Madeline. I have two sisters younger than I. And they were outside playing. And my father climbed into his truck. The truck was parked on the grass. And my dad climbed into his truck and he turned the ignition key on. And when he did so, he noticed that the fuel gauge was registering full. And my dad knew that he had an empty tank. As a matter of fact, he was on his way to go and fill the tank up. But now that he's turning on the switch and the fuel tank is registering full, my dad thought something happened here. And so come to find out, what had happened is Madeline and Rebecca were playing gas station. And they had a hose and they had turned the water on and they filled my dad's tank with water. And so after they recovered and came out of the hospital, my father had a real firm conversation with them. My dad didn't get all uptight. Like, Madeline was around 6 years old and Becky was around 4. They didn't understand. They were simply playing. And so Jesus is making it very, very clear to us that we are quick to forgive our children. It would be wise if we are quick to forgive one another. And so when Peter begins to speak and says, if my brother sins against me, and how often shall I forgive him? Up to 7 times. Well, he's actually asking a question that pertains to something Jesus had already spoken about. Because remember in verse 15, here in chapter 18, how Jesus said, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. So what has happened is Peter obviously is listening to Jesus and he's thinking about what Jesus is speaking about. And Jesus spoke concerning a brother sinning against you. And now he wants to know how you go about that. How do you go about forgiving somebody? You see, normally seeking revenge, or what we may think is justice, seeking justice or revenge is our normal and natural response. We remember that old phrase, I don't get mad, I get even. And that's a natural response. There was a king of France by the name of King Louis XII, and he said, nothing smells so sweet as the dead body of your enemy. And so that's a natural kind of mentality that we can have, holding grudges and remembering, even nurturing past hurts is actually very natural for us. And we can remember the painful and often forget about the good. So what we have here is a lesson on how to learn to forgive. And Jesus is giving us insight in this passage. So again, in verse 21, notice how it says, Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? And so, again, Jesus had just said, if your brother sins against you, it would seem that struck a chord in the heart of the apostle Peter. He asked the question, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? So when he says, how often shall my brother, that gives us insight that he's speaking about a fellow believer. How often shall a fellow believer sin against me and I forgive him? And then I want you to notice something that you might not even notice upon first reading. He gives it a number up until 7 times. Now, the question is this. What if a brother, a fellow believer, intentionally and habitually sins against me? How many times are they able to be restored to fellowship with me? How much mercy am I supposed to show a brother who sins against me? How often am I supposed to say, I forgive you? What if he does it more than once? What if he continues to do it? What if he does it up to 7 times? Now, when you read 7 times, you might not understand what he's speaking about, but during that time, the rabbis said that you didn't have to forgive that often. You see, the rabbis were teaching at that time that you only needed to forgive up to 3 times. Now, where did they get that from? They got it from the Old Testament, the book of Amos in chapter 1, verse 3. Because in Amos chapter 1, verse 3, it says, thus says the Lord, for 3 transgressions of Damascus and for 4, I will not turn away its punishment because they have threshed Gilead with implements of iron. So the rabbis, when they were studying Amos chapter 1, verse 3, reasoned that if God only forgives 3 times and punishes on the 4th, it would be arrogant for a man to forgive more than God forgives. And so during that time, they said that if somebody sins against you three times, you forgive them. If they sin against you a fourth time, you'd be going even beyond God in forgiving them. So it may be that as the Apostle Peter is asking this question, that he may even be expecting to be commended a bit from Jesus because he's got a compassionate spirit. You know, the Bible does teach us that we are to be merciful, doesn't it? And the Bible does teach us that we are to be forgiving. In Zechariah chapter 7, verse 9, it says, this is what the Lord Almighty says, administer true justice, show mercy and compassion to one another. So perhaps he feels that Jesus will commend him for his compassionate spirit, and thus he says, up till seven times. But notice Jesus' response, verse 22. Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Now, Peter is thinking in the manner that our fallen human nature is inclined to think. You see, forgiveness rests on people doing what he thinks that they should be doing. He doesn't have an understanding of God's merciful grace yet, and he doesn't understand the depth of God's forgiveness towards sinners. And so what Jesus will do here in this parable is he will teach disciples what forgiveness actually is. Somebody said forgiveness is not a matter of calculations, but rather a matter of the heart. Forgiveness is an expression of real love, and love is the earmark of a Christian. When Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 13 in verse 5, he speaks concerning love in this way. He says, it keeps no record of wrongs. And so Jesus is teaching us the essence of love and forgiveness. You see, genuine forgiveness has no set boundaries. So the point he's making is, have a forgiving spirit always. In Luke 17, he says it like this in verses 3 and 4. He says, watch yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times comes back to you and says, I repent, shoot him. No, forgive him. Forgive him. A heart that is tender enough to remain uncalloused is a great example of our God who is merciful. Jesus in Luke 6:36 said, be merciful just as your Father also is merciful. So we're going to see that forgiveness is not condoning, and forgiveness is not excusing, and forgiveness is not simply forgetting something that's been done to you. The word forgive means to release a debt that is owed to you. The word forgive speaks of sending something away or yielding something up. Somebody wrote, this means that if my brother offends me and I forgive him, I send away the offense from myself and from him so that it is never brought up again. If a person keeps bringing the same offense up, then they have never really sent it away, and they haven't truly forgiven. It's like that saying again, I forgive you, but I won't forget. It's that mentality. If you're holding on to it, you never released it. So a Christian's never to allow my ability to forgive to be surpassed by the sin of my brother against me. With this in mind, Jesus is giving a parable. He's teaching about forgiveness. That parable is found in verses 23 to the end of the chapter, to verse 35. And he speaks of it in this way. He says, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts. So this king is settling his accounts, and he's receiving the revenue that is due him from his ranking officials, which are tax collectors. And it says to us in verse 24, when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. And so we have here a story about a man who owes a king a considerable amount of money. What has happened is they have gone out and they had taken the taxes, collected them, but now they're supposed to be turning in the revenue that they've collected. But this man has an impossible sum to pay back. Jesus does that on purpose. He gives an exaggerated sum to give us an emphasis. He says this man owed him 10,000 talents. Now, we don't use the word talent to describe money today, so it's hard for us to really understand exactly what he's saying here. And the way to discover this, or to at least begin to give some preliminary calculations as to why Jesus would say 10,000 talents, is to simply remember that when we get to chapter 20, you're going to see in verses 2 and verse 13 that during this time, a common day laborer made what was called a denarii. They made one denarii a day. So a day's labor, one denarii. A talent, when Jesus speaks of this talent, a talent is equal to 6,000 denarii. So for a worker making 6 denarii per week, it would take 1,000 weeks to earn one talent. Now, to save one talent would take much longer. To save 10,000 talents would take 10 million weeks. That would be equivalent to 192,307 years. So the number is intended to communicate a debt that is impossible to pay. That's why Jesus uses that number. When he said in verse 24, when he began to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. This is an amount that he cannot pay back. So the royal official hasn't turned in the revenue that he's collected. It may represent several years of collecting taxes, keeping them for himself. He's unable to pay because he's embezzled it and consumed it. And so as this has taken place in verses 25 through 27, the master, it says he was not able to pay. His master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, that payment be made. And the servant fell down before him saying, "Master, have patience with me. I will pay you all." And the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him and forgave him the debt. And so what we have here is the illustration. Let's look at it together. Because during this time, a person in debt could sell himself as an indentured servant to try and pay off that debt. So Jesus is speaking about somebody who is actually being thrown into servitude to work off a debt. When we look at it and see what the heart of this would be, one, we see that this is a picture of a bankrupt sinner. This is somebody who owes God, and that God is bringing that person into accountability. Now, the Bible says it very clearly that each one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Romans 14 tells us that. Each one of us will give an account of himself to God. Ecclesiastes 12:14 says, "God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." Every secret thing. Everything that we think we got away with, God brings into judgment, and God scrutinizes that because the eyes of the Lord are upon everything. So there's nothing hidden from his sight. He sees it all, and ultimately one day we're going to stand before him, and we have an insurmountable debt that we owe to the Lord. You see, actually everything that I have belongs to him anyway. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7, Paul said, "What makes you better than anyone else, and what do you have that God hasn't given you? And if all you have is from God, why do you boast as though you have accomplished something on your own?" In 1 Chronicles 29:11, it says, "Yours, O God, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in the heavens and on earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things." And again, Psalm 24:1, "The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell there, and everything belongs to him. And I'm accountable to him for everything in my life." And so I am going to be brought into accountability. People are brought into accountability. This man was brought into accountability. Now, there's something else I want you to see here that may not seem so obvious. Notice verse 25. "He was not able to pay. His master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made." I want to talk to you about that for a second here. One, I owe God an insurmountable, a debt that I cannot pay on my own. That's what Jesus is emphasizing. Two, My rejection of the Lord, my rejection of God, my rejection of bowing my knee before Him, my rejection of the grace and mercy that He offers me does not simply affect me. It affects us. It affects us all. One of the things that we are failing to remember today in this society that we live in is that we're connected. That we all are connected. We're interconnected. We are so caught up today with this idea that it's my life and don't bother me. Don't rain on my parade. What bothers you is bothering you. It's your fault if it bothers you. It doesn't bother me. We have that mentality. It was in my era. It's part of human nature. It's pretty much because I'm into it for myself. I'm all about me anyway. I have to die to self in order to gain anything. And that's the heart of the Christian message is greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Because I am so caught up loving myself. When Jesus is asked the question, what is the great commandment in the law? He said, there are two. He says, one, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, He is one, and you should love Him with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. You should love God with everything. And two, there's a second command like unto the first. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, Jesus wasn't giving us three commands. He said there are two. Love God and love your neighbor. But what we've done is we've taken the second command He gave as it pertains to relationships. And He said, love your neighbor as yourself. And then there are those who get in a pulpit and will say, see, the Bible infers that I'm to love myself. That's not what Jesus taught. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. What are you saying, Jesus, that it's okay to love myself and put myself before my neighbor? No, He's not saying that at all. He's saying with the same intensity that you have in preserving yourself, you need to turn that around and care about other people. Because the gospel speaks concerning us loving. God so loved the world He gave, and Christians are those who lay their lives down. That's how you demonstrate Christianity. But what we have today is it's all about me. It's about my wishes, my wants, my desires, my plans, the things that I have as goals. We put ourselves so far before everybody else that we're willing to just lose our family if I get what I wanted. That's what we do. I will lose. Look, I'm not happy in my marriage right now. I'm so upset with what's going on. I'll just dump it. But I don't think in terms of the child or the children that are being affected by my desire to be free of this. So it's about me now, isn't it? It's about me. But the bottom line is, I want you to see this. In this, Jesus would be inferring that not only the man owes and is paying, but his wife and his children did too. You cannot sin in a vacuum. You can't. You will impact the entire nucleus of relationships that you have when you put yourself before others. That's what happens. This is not a popular message. You may not come back next week, but it's true. It's true. It's true. You hear what the Lord says and you do it. Christianity is dying to self. Do you think that it was easy for Jesus to die on the cross? If you do, you don't understand. It wasn't easy to leave the splendor of heaven knowing that His destiny was a lonely hill called Golgotha where He laid down His life for me. It wasn't easy. It was love. And sometimes love hurts. And Jesus died on a cross to teach me greater love has no man than this, that a man laid down his life for his friends. When you sin habitually, consistently, it isn't just you who pay the price. It's your children. If you're married, it's your wife. Everybody is hurt. Everybody is penalized. Everybody. Don't forget that. Because this is one of those parables. When Jesus speaks about it, sometimes people just are looking at the man who's thrown in prison and they're forgetting the wife and kids went too. The wife and the children are always affected when that man fails. They always are. And the husband and the children are always affected when that wife fails. And what Jesus is teaching us is impossible for us to do without God's help. It is impossible to be forgiving without God's help. Because I may forgive, but I don't forget. I may forgive, but I'm only releasing it for a while until you prove to me a year or 2 years later that you were not worthy of my trust. And then you do it again, and I say, see, I never really forgave you because I knew you'd do this again. That's a heavy, heavy thing to be looking at, but that's what we're looking at right now. You see, this is a picture of a man trying by his own efforts to work off a sin debt, and it is not possible. In Romans chapter 4, verse 5, Paul said it like this. He said, people are declared righteous because of their faith, not because of their work. And so as this is all going on, verse 26, he fell down before him. So what does he do? Well, he throws himself upon the mercy of the king, which is exactly what we are to do. Psalm 41, verse 4 says, I said, O Lord, have mercy on me. Heal me, for I have sinned against you. Have mercy on me. Heal me, I have sinned against you. You see, we seek the mercy of the Lord. Jesus would be illustrating that with this parable. We seek the mercy of the Lord, and he forgives us. Remember in Matthew 5, verse 3, how Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. And when we went through that passage, I pointed out that the word poor is a Greek word that speaks of to shrink or to crouch in a corner. It speaks of begging. And what he was speaking about was, blessed is the one who recognizes their own spiritual poverty, that they need mercy from God. Blessed is the one who recognizes his inability and need for the mercy of God. Blessed is the one who stands empty before God in total need of his mercy, in total need of his grace. You see, humility is the foundation of other graces, and until we understand how unworthy we are, we will not understand how worthy he is. And so the poor in spirit realize that they don't have a right relationship with the Lord, and so they come to God as humble beggars seeking for mercy and forgiveness. And that's what the Lord is teaching us there, and that's what he'd have us to understand now. And so the man goes before him, and he says, have patience with me, I will pay you all. Well, verse 27, the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. He released him of the debt. He reacted with compassion and released him. He completely forgave him of an unpayable debt. He actually treated it as if it were a loan, and he forgave it. In Micah chapter 7, verse 18, the question is asked, who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity, passing over the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in mercy. He delights in mercy. God rejoices, delights, it gives him great pleasure to extend mercy to those who ask. Well, what happened? Did he learn his lesson? Notice verse 28, that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. The fellow servant fell down at his feet, begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. He would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. And so, as he comes and speaks to him, notice with me in verse 28 how it speaks concerning that this fellow servant owed 100 denarii. Now, this gives to us the response to the mercy of the king. What does he do? Well, he goes out and he finds a debtor who owes him. So this reveals how he responded to the act of grace that had been bestowed on him. He went out, he found a fellow servant, and he remembered, this guy owes me 100 denarii. Now, this other servant would represent a fellow believer. He owed 100 denarii. 100 denarii is a considerable sum of money, but it's something you can pay. I mean, if you buy a house today, here, even in Chino, you get a house and the flies go along with it. When you buy a house here, even in Chino, you're looking at $400,000, $450,000. There's a housing project going on just up the street from us, just south of us right now. Some of you see it. It's just up the street, maybe a mile or so. It started out, if you would drive by there, because I drive by there every day, the houses that are for sale in that area there started out, when they first started building them, it said in the low 500s. But if you go buy it right now, and the houses aren't even complete, they don't even have the model homes ready to show. They're now in the low 600s. So you've seen $100,000 additional in the last 2 or 3 months. To buy a home, even in Chino, and some people say, Chino, are you kidding me? Who wants to live there? You know, this morning, Hawaiians aren't waking up saying, listen, I got to get to Chino for vacation. They're just not doing that. Or maybe they are. I have friends in Hawaii who say, you know, you'd be surprised, I would like to come back. They got heat stroke, because why would you want to come back? But when you I actually love Chino very much. I tease it because I love it. But the bottom line is, even here in our area, guys, you cannot buy a home, $350, $400, $450. It's all going up, right? My first home cost me $47,000. And I told my dad, house payments are going to cost me $500 a month. This is killing me. It's going to kill me. And my dad, I still remember my dad saying to me, son, there's going to be a day when you think $500 a month is cheap. And I remember responding to my dad by saying, I hope that day never comes. Hey, it's here. It's here. My first house, 47 and a half. But it's something you can pay for. It's something you can buy. You can get a, 30-year loan. You can pay it back. What he's dealing with here is a good sum of money, 100 denarii, 100 days' wages. But it's negotiable. It's something that can be paid versus a debt that's 192,000 years. And so that gives to us the insight into the fact that this other servant, this other believer, sinned in a slight way against him in comparison to all the sins that this man had sinned against God. And so when you start to take into consideration the amount of mercy God has given to me as a habitual sinner over a lifetime, well, when somebody has sinned against me, Jesus is comparing it and saying that there is no comparison. A man's sins against God are always going to be much greater than a man's sin against another man. But here comes this man, and he says, pay me what you owe. And he treats him brutally, grabs him by the throat. And the man says exactly, by the way, the same thing that he had said, this other man had said to the master. Have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Same words, different response. He cast him into debtor's prison to make him pay back what he owed. Instead of being merciful, he became vindictive. Now, as this is taking place, verse 31, his fellow servants saw what had been done. They were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. People saw what was happening and noticed the sorrow of their heart. They know this is wrong. It's not right that two people should be in such conflict. It's wrong for what this man did, especially in light of the fact that so much mercy had been shown to the first one, and so little mercy or no mercy was shown to the other one. And so they're upset, and they come and report him and say, this is what has taken place. This man has treated him in this way. It affects them, and it causes them sorrow of heart. The way that people in this church or in churches throughout the world may be aware of two brothers or a brother and sister or whatever in a church having conflict, and they're grieved by that. They're grieved by it. They see the anger. They see what's going on, and it causes sorrow of heart. You know somebody who's having a problem with somebody else, and you've encouraged them. You said, listen, the Lord has given to us the way to remedy that. Go and speak to your brother himself alone and win him back. Go and do that. Well, I don't want to. You don't understand. He owes me. He owes me. You don't understand. You don't know what they've done to me. You don't know how they've spoken to me. You don't know how they've treated me. He owes me. And that's what happens. And what happens here is it grieves other people. There are people in churches whose hearts are broken because they know of conflict that takes place amongst members of that congregation. And so they're grieved, and they go and speak to the master. They're grieved and told him. So what happens? Well, notice verse 32, his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry, delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. And so my heavenly Father also will do to each of you if you don't from your heart forgive your brother his trespasses. So what happens? Well, he speaks to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you everything. Now, what does this teach us? Let's make this as practical as we can. It reveals that this servant didn't appreciate or understand the meaning of forgiveness. Here's something for you. It's so basic. We all know this, but let me say it anyway. You can't give what you don't have. You can't give what you don't have. How do I give forgiveness if I haven't accepted it myself? How do I understand the depth of it if I haven't humbled myself and received from God His mercy and compassion? This is one of those things, by the way, that you learn over time. It's an amazing thing, but it's true. You can learn this quick or you can learn it slowly, but you will learn it. You will learn it. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you will learn how to forgive. You will learn that if you have a heart to follow Christ. If you don't, then you're going to be handed over to the tormentors, to the torturers. Your life is going to be miserable because you always have in the back of your mind, this person owes me. This person owes me. And I don't trust them. This person owes me. They've hurt me. I'll never forget. I'll never forget. Oh, I say I've forgiven, but I've never released you. You will always owe me. And I will bring it up. I will say something to you at the appropriate time. I will say something to you about it whenever you have upset me. And families, we see this happen in fights with a husband and a wife all the time, or with a parent and a child. They say to the kid, you know what? I can't trust you. I let you go and you did this. I don't trust you. And you pour into that child this sense that you will never, never trust them because they are not earning your trust. And you'll even say that you've got to earn my trust. But how much do they have to do to earn that trust? What do they have to do? How much do they have to do until you let it go? How much? Some of you will appreciate this and others won't. Again, I understand. As my children were growing up, and they would do something that children do, they will do wrong things, I would sit them down and I'd have a conversation with them and I would talk to them and I explained to them, and when they were young, I would explain to them, this is what you did wrong. This, if they wanted to argue, I had all night long. You can argue with me all day if you want, doesn't matter. You know, there were times when I would simply let them say what they're saying, and I'd say something to the effect, listen, this isn't a conversation. This is a correction. And until you see the point that I'm making, this conversation is going to continue until the correction occurs. So, it's up to you. How long you want to talk? And we would talk. And when they finally would say to me, which they did, Dad, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done that. This is how I handled it. I would look at them, we would pray, and I would say, from this point on, this will not be brought up again. It's in the sea of forgetfulness. It's over, it's done, no more. And they can tell you, I don't bring things up to my kids. I don't remind them of what they've done. I don't. Because they ask for forgiveness, I release that debt. It's gone, it's over, no more. Not everybody does that. Some people say, oh, I'm in the back of my mind, you know, I'm not going to forget this because you've shown me what you are. And they will live up to or down to your expectations. If you say that they're going to do it again, what good does it do? What good does it do? Here's something for you that you may not appreciate, but I'll say it anyway. I was the kid that if you told my dad or my mom, anybody said, I don't like what you did, I was the kid that you would have hated, because I was the kid who would say, I don't care. Dad said, blah, 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 and I'd say, Dad, to be honest with you, I really don't care. How can you? I just don't. I don't care. If you like it, fine. If you don't like it, fine. Doesn't matter to me. I really don't care. And I could tell you stories. You're not here to hear my stories, but I'll tell you, that's where my heart was. That's the bottom line. That's a fact. That's a fact. Hurt me once, shame on me. Hurt me once, shame on you. Hurt me twice, shame on me. No, you're not going to hurt me twice. You know, I don't care. I don't care enough about you to even worry about it. And then I get saved, and then I start reading the Bible, and it says, forgive those who have hurt you. And I say, how can you do that? Because they've hurt me bad. How do I do that? And Jesus taught me. He said, how much did I forgive you? Everything. And why can't you release that debt that they owe you? They asked. Did it happen overnight? No. Did it happen in a year? No. It took years for me to actually learn to release debts. And I do that now. I release debts. I'm not going to hold on to them. Why? Why waste your life being angry at somebody who's already said they're sorry? Why waste your life blaming them for things that can't be changed? You cannot go back into time and change it. It happened. It's done. They said, forgive me. I have to release their debts, because if I don't, I'm tortured. It's in the back of my mind. I'm always hurt. I'm always angry. And the point is, when you forgive someone, you let it go. Does that mean you don't learn lessons? No, you learn your lessons. That doesn't mean you run around all gullible and all. And no, it simply means that you're not going to hold them to a standard that God didn't hold you to. When Jesus died on that cross and forgave me of my sins, he forgave me for all of them. All of them. And if I confess my sin, he is faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. He didn't hold it back and didn't say, see, David, I knew what you do. I knew you this way. He didn't do that. You know, spiritually, I see what God did. He covered my sin with the blood of Christ. He forgave me. And if he forgave me, who am I not to forgive you? Who am I to make you pay me back? Who am I to do that to you? So I've learned over the years, release the debt. Because I'm not angry at people anymore. I'm not looking at that person walking up saying, oh, I remember what you did anymore. You know, if you said you're sorry, I forgive you, let's move on. But if you stole from me, don't expect me to loan you any money. I learned my lessons. But at the same time, Jesus taught me release. Release. Now, sometimes people wonder about that. But I've discovered that unforgiveness produces broken friendships. It produces remorse. It produces a pained conscience. It can even develop into a life of rejection. So this kind of life continues because forgiveness of sins is intended to remove those things from a person. When the psalmist said, well, the psalmist said in Psalm 32, verse 2, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, in whose spirit there is no deceit. Blessed is that man that God forgives. And when God has forgiven you, then we forgive somebody else. So what do we learn? Well, to summarize, one, through this parable, we learn that we're all debtors to God and that we cannot pay off our own debt. I need it to be forgiven. Second, I discover that it is on the basis of his mercy that he forgives me, because he has compassion on me. And then third, if I have been forgiven, then I am to forgive those who have sinned against me. When they come, we're talking about a brother or a sister in the Lord, when they come and say, forgive me, I am to forgive them. And then fourth, I discover that my life will be miserable until I let go and forgive other people. Because unforgiveness will always result in bitterness, and bitterness will always torture you. It always will. Judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy, but mercy triumphs over judgment. So here's a simple test to evaluate if you have forgiven those who have hurt you. One, can you thank God for the lessons that you've learned even when in pain? Two, can you talk about the event without bitterness, resentment, hurt, anger, or desire for revenge? Three, if you had any blame at all, or you had part of the blame, have you accepted that? Four, can you revisit the scene without negative feelings? Five, can you reward those who hurt you? And six, can you pray for God's best for them? Can you? God, in Jesus' name, bless their life. God, I'm not going to hold this in my heart anymore. I need to release it. I am in torment. I think about it. It's always before me. I need it to be released because I want to move on. Your life is short. It's too short to be a debt collector. It's too short to always remember the pain that people caused you. You know, when my mama went home to be with Jesus, she went through her last years of life in a bed. She had a broken back. My mom couldn't walk. My mom had fallen down and not only broken her back, she broke ribs and she couldn't get out of bed. She only was able to get out for basic things and she had to come back. And mama went through dementia. And at the end of her life, mama was remembering a lot of the painful things that had happened to her. It was a very difficult thing. I'll tell you something. I really want to live a life right now where I've allowed the blood of Christ to cover those things so that in my last days, I'm not thinking of how somebody hurt me or said something about me or did something. You know, just yesterday, my wife Marie and I were talking, and I said, you know, honey, I said to her something like this. I said, if I were to sit down from the day this church began to where we're at now to remember the things that have been said and the things that have been done, I said, it really is an amazing thing that you and I have remained in ministry because so many cruel things and so many bad things have been said and done to us and our family. I said, it's all the grace of God, isn't it? It's all the love of God, isn't it? Because what the Lord has done is He's given to us, both Marie and me, this grace in the Lord to say, you know what? If you said, I'm sorry, it's done. It's over. The blood of Christ covers it. It's down in the depths of the sea. It's never to be retrieved. Let's move on in Jesus and see what God wants to do. And I'm able to do that because of the Lord. I'm able to do that because He did that for me. And Jesus said, He said, no. If you don't forgive, you won't experience what forgiveness is because you don't understand forgiveness. Your debt to God is greater than any man will ever owe you. And until you understand that, you're going to be a debt collector. But I say to the Lord, no, Lord, I don't want to be a debt collector. I want to release it into your hands. You forgave me. May I forgive others.